evening and welcome to the Tin Mountain Conservation Center and this evening of thanks. The commercial is that there's not going to be a formal offering taken, as in many of our traditions, but there is a jar for gifts that will remain here at the Tin Mountain Conservation Center. So if you feel so ruled, our evening is brought to you by the jar. As we gather tonight to celebrate and express our gratitude for life and love and all the beauty that surrounds us, we are also painfully aware of the divisions and the separations and the wall building and the fencing off within our world. So our hope tonight is that this will be a time that we spend together creating a symbol of what can be when there is genuine welcome. The celebration and appreciation of diversity. Belief in the rich giftedness of community. An honoring of our mutual vulnerability. The nurturing of courage and respect for the unfamiliar. There will be opportunities tonight for song and silence, ancient readings and poetry, time to share and reflect, time to bless and give thanks. So on behalf of this eclectic clergy lunch group, we welcome you tonight and hope you will find food for your soul. Welcome, everyone.
Meditation on breathing. Some of you know it, the rest of you will pick it up very quickly. Breathe in.
to other you. You've been there, where, then, and now. Longing and gratitude sit side by side at the late autumn table.
Longing for more time, more courage, more strength, more love, more wisdom to make it right. Peace in our time or any. Safe harbor. Welcome. Healing. Companionship. Understanding.
Gratitude rises for glimpses of all that and more. Enough to hope and pray and engage with the world where its need meets us in morning light.
What will I do this day to increase the chances of peace and understanding?
How will I ease the suffering of another grieving creature?
What tender living thing or stony, silent place, what grove, what grass will I honor and cherish?
The world is quiet as snow and wild as wind, and is ours but a moment to be a blessing for it. May gratitude win the day, may love rule our hearts, and may we bless and be blessed all our days. Blessed be, amen.
Thank you. Thanksgiving poem by Rumi. Thanksgiving is sweeter than bounty itself. One who cherishes gratitude does not cling to the gift. Thanksgiving is the true meat of God's beauty. The bounty is its shell. For thanksgiving carries you to the heart of the beloved. Abundance alone brings heedlessness. Thanksgiving gives birth to alertness. The bounty of thanksgiving will satisfy and elevate you, and you will bestow 100 bounties in return. Eat your fill of God's delicacies, and you will be freed from hunger and begging.
For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams and pools of water, with springs flowing in the valleys and the hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the earth. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large and your silver and gold increase and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful desert, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the desert, something your fathers had never known, to humble and to test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember, the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers, as it is today.
During our time this evening, we'd like for any of you who wish to do so to share some of your own brief words about gratitude. The kind of gratitude that rises in us like a warm tide. I've known such moments, such events. So if you, that sunset, first whiff of wood smoke in late September or early October, the warm weight of your dog's head in your lap, your child's small face laughing or in repose, waking up next to your best friend, or remembering the years when it was your privilege to do so. These funny little daily happenings, why is it that they can slip by us unnoticed for weeks at a time, and then suddenly and without warning, we are filled up and spilling over with a feeling of gratitude? And who do you thank? Thank your lucky stars. Thank goodness. Thank God. All be praised. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you have heard me tell the story of a friend whose mother ran an interfaith daycare center in She had to come up with an acceptable little grace for snack time. Warm milk and graham crackers, probably stale. And so she composed this small verse. Thank you, Zeus, for the cookies and juice. Thank someone. For what are you particularly grateful? I'm thinking of the turkey that stopped us dead in our tracks coming up here this evening, driving up 16, came out and stood right in front of our car. And the cars piled up in both directions and everybody waited. When, if you care to speak, or even in silence, you may choose a stone from this humble collection here. Just to remember this day, you can take it home with you if you want. Or you can name that for which you are grateful and place the stone, it's a glass bowl. Place the stone gently in the waters.
Thinking of the housing struggles we have here in the valley, and I'm very grateful that I have landlords from out of town who are not out for the green paper, and I have an affordable apartment.
To do the Doktor and Mayas. It truly changed my soul.
Grateful for the abundance of food that we have.
As many of you know, I will be retiring in a week. And I am so enormously grateful for the time I've spent in the valley because of the people of my parish, the people of the clergy, of the slippery slope we sometimes call ourselves. So I'm grateful for all the people, and I'm going to be selfish and take this stone with me that has been mingled and be a reminder of you all. So thank you.
I'm thankful for friends and family that support me in times of need.
For my family, for my health, and for the children that I have met over the years that have absolutely changed everything about me. I'm thankful for nature. I love when I go out on walks, being able to find the right treasure, so that's why I pause. But I'm thankful for family and support and prayers. I had an uncle who was supposed to not make it through surgery this past week, and he came through with flying colors, and you know, our family gathered for that, and it was really precious. So I love, you know, I'm thankful for all my family. I also was in Boston last night visiting my daughter, who I adore, and we were out walking. We saw, sadly, an expression of hate through some marching that was particularly upsetting near the Holocaust memorial. But I also saw a lot of love and restraint with a lot, way more people, and that was, I'm really thankful for that. But, you know, we're all in this together, and there's a lot of good out there.
I'm thankful that my dad, who is 101 years old, has his entire life kept growing and thinking and changing and loves the universe and gave me a sense of awe and a telescope, you know, at it. And so whenever I get a chance to be in a dark place and just see the majesty
course, the mountains and the beauty. So I guess the relationship with both people and creation that is possible here. I'm grateful.
I'm grateful because I got to grow up in the inner city, in a neighborhood where nobody had much, and so we all had to look after each other. So the Hungarians lived next door to us, the Bulyeis, they escaped, our regime. And the Miskas lived up on our third floor. Mrs. Robinson lived in the basement because she got in some sort of passport trouble, so she became our housekeeper. I don't know if we kept her, but she kept us. The Kaplans lived across the street, the Ganyans next door, and I guess growing up we never knew that we didn't have anything, so we were all sort of equal. But my parents had taught us we always had to be grateful and help people and invite them in. And last month, my older brother finally succumbed to MS, very independent, and I always knew he would die alone in his apartment. But the night he died, he invited a friend in who had no place to go. And in fact, he did not die alone. And I'm grateful that things are remembered and become ingrained in us, and that we become so much a part of each other. And that's a true blessing.
Grateful to be alive, and so many of my unit members are not, because the thing we call life gives us experiences that we may not always have. It's allowed me to experience the greatest sense of gratefulness I've ever experienced in my entire life, which is a woman that I love and two beautiful little girls.
This quiet space and time in the midst of this sometimes storm of the world. And for all of your breathing, heartbeating selves being here with us. I'm going to follow Gil's example and keep this stone clay especially. So also for the beauty of the earth. Sing with me if you would.
Over and around the
Shouts of joy to the mouth and to the wren and to the sleeping dug-up clam, telling them all over and over how it is that we live forever.
Thanksgiving is one of those holidays when the feast has a constancy. Butter, stuffing, butter, pies, sugar, butter. But what changes, what really evolves, is the circle at the table, the circle of generations at the table. Unitarian Universalist minister Mary Wellmeyer writes about making pie. This is the very pumpkin pie my grandmother made, almost. She was a modern woman who knew how to follow recipes, receipts she called them, because they had been received. She had a rule for pie crust that was constant until from time to time it changed. I have that rule in turn, and it has moved on just a bit from where she left it. This is my special shared moment with her, departed a quarter century. As I work, I'm all ages of myself, and the thought of my tall son comes to join us, though he hardly knew her. He makes pies with wild abandon, sculpting them from material and artistry. He has received pie somehow on the soul level. The three of us make pie together, preheating the oven, cutting the butter into flour, adding water, flouring a board, rolling the crust. To honor her, I follow the recipe. change just one thing.
And to honor myself, I take my time and smile.
Perhaps the world ends here. By joy, Harjo. The world begins at a kitchen table. No matter what, we must eat to live. The gifts of earth are brought and prepared and set on the table. So it has been since creation, and it will go on. We chase chickens or dogs away from it. Babies teeth at the corners. They scrape their knees under it. It is here that children are given instructions on what it means to be human. We make men at it. We make women. At this table, we gossip, recall enemies and the ghosts of lovers. Our dreams drink coffee with us as they put their arms around our children. They laugh with us at our poor falling down selves and as we put ourselves back together once again at the table. This table has been a house in the rain, an umbrella in the sun. Wars have begun and ended at this table. It is a place to hide in the shadow of terror, a place to celebrate the terrible victory. We have given birth on this table and have prepared our parents for burial here. At this table, we sing with joy, with sorrow. We pray of suffering and remorse, and we give thanks. Perhaps the world will end at the kitchen table while we are laughing and crying, eating of the last sweet bite.
So not to curtail anybody's Thanksgiving, feel free to continue to come up. We're going to sing a song called We Thank You, written by a woman named Susan Savelle. And she does it with wild rocking old piano. I don't. But Sean will play the drum. The drum. And you'll pick it right up. You'll pick it right up. There were spaces within it where you didn't have the opportunity to sing out, shout out, whisper something for which you were grateful. And if you want to still come up and grab a rock and keep it or toss it in, you can. And we'll just sing it for a while. It goes like this. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for the gift of the Spirit of Life. And then it's a break where you get to say something. And then we all come back in. So it's like this. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for the gift of the Spirit of Life. We thank you.
Thank you.
Was a witness of diversity tonight and commonality. It was a sharing of things that are very deep, very precious. I need to be together in the great variety of life experience. We hope that this has been a time to really take in the connectedness that is life. We are all the same. Dalai Lama says, all the same person. We have something very precious in that knowledge to take out into this world and be that beauty that we all are. May this time bless us all. Bless us all. Now and forever. May it be so.
I'll try not to sing in the basement this time, I will.